What is a multiple sclerosis attack, a flare, a relapse, an exacerbation? What does all that mean? I'm going to answer that question starting right now. If this is your first time joining the channel, thanks a lot. Make sure to subscribe and click the notifications button so you can keep up to date on all of our new content. The formal definition of a multiple sclerosis attack is a new neurological deficit, or an old one that's been away for at least 1 month and now has come back. It lasts for longer than 24 hours. It occurs in the absence of a fever, and it's associated with findings on neurological examination. Whew, that's a lot of words to describe an attack. If I use more simple language, it's when you have a new neurological problem. You can't see out of your eye, or your hand's clumsy, or you can't feel this hand. Something bad's happened to you, and you try to go about your day and blow it off, and 24, 40 hours later, darn it, it's still there. That's an attack. And when someone with MS has an attack, they need to tell their provider. This is very important. You have to reach out and call the provider and say, I'm having new neurological symptoms, and I have to get into your office to be seen. That's very important. We need to see you in clinic. We have to listen to your history. We have to do a careful neurological examination to find findings on exam to buttress what you're telling us. Once we do that, we need to check for a urinary tract infection or an upper respiratory tract infection, because if you have said infection, it might be triggering a pseudo attack. Pseudo is the Greek word for similar to, but it ain't. And a pseudo attack is when someone with MS who has previously had damage they've mostly recovered from, then gets an infection. It can be something simple like a UTI they don't even know about, but it raises your core body temperature just enough that it causes those old damaged areas to short circuit. Imagine that 10 years ago you had an optic neuritis and it almost fully recovered, maybe 90%. Now you get a urinary tract infection that you're not even aware of. Your core body temperature raises and it short circuits the eye, and then you go blind. Now, when you treat the urinary tract infection, the core body temperature goes back down and the vision returns. That's a pseudo attack and doesn't require steroids. If we don't identify a pseudo attack, now it's time for us to treat the attack. So let's talk about that. Treating an MS attack starts with high-dose corticosteroids. Corticosteroids are not the kind of steroids that you hear about that bodybuilders take or sports people take. These are potent anti-inflammatory medicines. Through the vein intravenously, we can give people a drug called IV solumedrol. That's typically given in a dose of a full gram, and it's given daily for typically 5 days. At least that's... There are many other ways to treat an attack. We oftentimes will prescribe high-dose oral prednisone pills. Now, because the pills only come in 50 milligram tablets, and in order to create the bioequivalence of a gram of solumedrol, we have to give 1,250 milligrams of oral prednisone. That turns out to be 25 pills. I'm being serious. You take 25 of these 50 milligram tablets each morning for 5 mornings. That's the bioequivalence of the IV. It's also the same efficacy. It works just as well. And it's the same safety and tolerability. And so that's another option to treat an attack, because high-dose steroids have a safety profile that we have to be aware of. We don't want to give someone high-dose steroids if they have diabetes, if they had gestational diabetes, and in those circumstances, we need to have help with the primary care doctor or the endocrinologist so that we can adjust insulin levels during the course of the steroids. We don't want to give someone steroids if they've previously had a bleeding ulcer from steroids, or if they currently have ulcers, or they have a history of GI bleeds. We would want to check that out and talk to the GI guy or to the primary care doctor long before giving them steroids. And we might have to use special medicines in addition to keep them safe. We also wouldn't want to give someone steroids, obviously, if they have a history of psychosis with steroids. That's fortunately very rare, but it can happen. And so these are some of the safety considerations before taking steroids to recover from an attack. If we use high-dose steroids to treat an attack and we're not successful, we then turn our attention to second-line therapies. We typically reserve the phoresis or the Acthar or the IVIG for severe attacks that have not fully recovered. We can sometimes use a medicine called IVIG, And this is also given intravenously. The second option would be to use a medicine called ACTH. The brand name is Acthar. And this is a hormone which you inject into your skin, and it causes your body to make its own steroids. That's another option. A third very powerful option, when people have an attack and don't recover, and it's a serious attack, we then consider second line therapy with total plasma exchange, or plasmapheresis. And in order to do this, we typically have to put large special IVs in your neck or in your chest. Rarely we can do it in your arm. And we take the blood out, filter it, and put it back. And this is typically done, total plasma exchange, about 5 to 7 exchanges done every other day. So it can take 10 to 14 days to complete. Another important consideration is that when you have an attack, that's not the goal. We don't want you to have attacks. And in fact, we give you these medicines called disease-modifying therapies to prevent you from having an attack. Now, I think of the disease-modifying therapies like a birth control pill. If you're taking a birth control pill and you get pregnant, then it didn't work. If you're taking a disease-modifying therapy and you had an attack, something's not right. It doesn't mean that we're gonna remove the drug and switch immediately, but it does mean that you need to think about that, and you need to have a conversation with your provider. Say, hey, I'm taking this medicine, I had an attack, does this mean it's not working? Should we consider changing? And that's a conversation that you and your provider should have anytime that there's an attack. The last piece of information I want to leave you with is the importance of follow-up after an attack. If you have a new optic neuritis and we give you high-dose steroids, we shouldn't wait months to see you back in clinic. No, we need to see you back, in my opinion, in 4 to 6 weeks. Why? If you haven't fully recovered, we're going to consider those second-line therapies that I mentioned earlier in the video. And so, when you have an attack, you need to tell your provider. You need to be examined. You need to be checked for a urinary tract infection. And if we give you therapies, we need to have you follow up in clinic to see if we've made you better so that we know whether or not we need to give more. Lastly, we need to consider whether or not the current disease-modifying therapy that you're taking is working or not. There's a lot to consider with an attack, but it's important. And I appreciate your attention today. I would love to hear from you guys. Do me a favor and leave your comment below and tell me, the last time that you were treated for an attack, what did we use? Did you receive IV steroids? Did you receive high-dose oral steroids? Have you ever gotten IVIG for an attack? How about plasma exchange or Acthar? Share with us what that experience was like.